And next up, we have Michelangelo Sabatino. He will be speaking about the book project that we've been working on for 10 years. Michelangelo Sabatino trained as an architect, a preservationist, and a historian. And he currently serves as director of the PhD program at IIT Architecture in Chicago, and is the John Vinci Distinguished Research Fellow there. Michelangelo earned a laureate in architecture at the University of Venice, and then a doctorate at the Department of Fine Art, University of Toronto, which is his hometown. He held a postdoctoral fellowship in the Department of History of Art and Architecture at Harvard, and has taught history and theory of architecture at Yale and the University of Houston before coming to IIT in Chicago in 2014. Michelangelo has a ferocious appetite for publishing. He publishes regularly in scholarly journals and anthologies. His monograph, Pride in Modesty, Modernist Architecture and the Vernacular Tradition in Italy, is a milestone, and I think one of the books that really belongs in the tradition of New Harmony, of looking at the rural vernacular as a generator for modernism. This book won enormous critical acclaim, including from the Society of Architects and Historians. He loves to co-edit books and worked on Canada, Modern Art, Architectures and History. Currently, Michelangelo serves on the board of directors of Docomomo, U.S. Docomomo U.S. is the U.S. chapter of Docomomo International, which is a non-profit organization dedicated, and this is enormously important for us here, dedicated to the documentation and conservation of buildings, sites, and neighborhoods of the modern movement for the last 25 years. And in his capacity as the Docomomo U.S. board member, he has served as juror for the Modernism in America Awards Program. Award-winning projects highlight the best in preservation practice by today's architects, designers, and preservation professionals for modern sites, landscapes, and beyond. So please help me welcome Michelangelo Sabatino.
Good afternoon. Thank you, Ben, for your kind introduction. Thank you, above all, for introducing me to New Harmony and for sharing your insights and knowledge over these past 10 years. Special call out, of course, is to Connie Weinzappel, who has been a generous sort of supporter all these years. And, of course, auspicious welcome to Dan. Where are you, Dan? That he may continue this tradition and do even better, if that's possible. So, I don't know if anyone has seen it yet, but this is the book that we have labored for 10 years, and we hope that it will serve this community well, because that is the intention. The intention was not just to produce a book, to another book to put on the bookshelf, but to use the knowledge generated herein to then be able to make judicious plans for how to preserve and understand the built environment and architecture. I make a specific distinction between built environment and architecture because the two are different but complementary. With the publication of Jane Glaffer Owen's memoir 4 years ago, New Harmony, Indiana, Like a River, Not a Lake, and our Avant-Garde in the Cornfields, Architecture, Landscape, and Preservation in New Harmony, we bring to conclusion a collaborative effort that started nearly 10 years ago when Jane Glaffer Owen was still alive, and I met her, together with Ben, in Houston, Texas. We are especially pleased to have Nancy Manga McCaslin here with us today. Nancy, there you are. Since she not only helped shepherd Mrs. Owen's memoir to press, she also contributed an essay to our book and served as a managing editor, bringing together all of us in order to perform in the best possible way. I'm certain that many in this audience, like me, would have welcomed having Jane here, right in front of us today, sitting in the first row, listening attentively in the auditorium that she indirectly helped realize by bringing Ralph Schwartz to New Harmony. As we mentioned in the acknowledgments of our Avant-Garde in the Cornfields, Mrs. Owen envisioned our book as a scholarly complement to her memoir, in which she recounts from a personal perspective her decades-long efforts to transform New Harmony from a Midwestern town with a storied past that had suffered some neglect over the decades to a site where local and cosmopolitan forces converged to make it into a sophisticated and welcoming place. It is no coincidence that we have chosen a book title that emphasizes seemingly discordant, oxymoronic realities. All too often, city dwellers, including those from Chicago, consider the metropolis as the only source of creative achievements and fail to acknowledge that in the middle of places, like the cornfields of Indiana, you can actually foster avant-garde practices of all sorts, ranging from the artistic and cultural to the political. Thanks to Mrs. Owen's deep respect for the two founding communities that helped shape New Harmony in the 19th century, and many public and private partners at the local and state level who contributed to New Harmony's transformation during the 20th century, we understand that cosmopolitan as well as grassroots sophistication need not only be found in New York, London, Tokyo, or Paris. Mrs. Owen's progressive vision for New Harmony emerged gradually as she sought to construct a new New Harmony in which the past and future could coexist. It is not by coincidence that Jane would often paraphrase the thinking of Paul Tillich, one of her great spiritual mentors, who wrote the following in his 1932, The Religious Situation. To understand the present means to see it in its inner tension toward the future. In this field also, there is such a thing as spiritual and the possibility of finding, amid all the infinite aspirations and tensions which every present contains, not only those which conserve the past, but also those which are creatively new and pregnant with the future. This photo of the Harmonist era David Lentz house, a handmade frame wood building, in the foreground of the Atheneum, a porcelain-coated steel-paneled building in the background, perfectly displays this coexistence of two radically different yet complementary traditions, realities. Just as Jane Owen's vision did not emerge overnight, so too did not the conceptual framework of our book. After receiving various degrees of feedback from blind, anonymous, and not so blind or kind peer reviewers, we realized that focusing only on Mrs. Owen's patronage of avant-garde architecture, landscape, and gardens, while leaving out her preservation efforts, would have undermined the overall complexity of this story. By placing architecture, landscape, and preservation together in our book, we too sought to capture the inner tension Paul Tillich so eloquently described. It is worth recalling that during the 1920s and 1930s, while John D. Rockefeller Jr. was subsidizing the return of Williamsburg to its 18th century roots, his wife, Abby Aldrich Rockefeller, launched the Avant-Garde Museum of Modern Art in New York. It is worth remembering that many of the great American 20th century architects and artists moved from bases from great cities like New York and Chicago to set up practices in remote places like Abiquiu, New Mexico, for Georgia Keith here. She is opening her window to a beautiful view of the Pedernal. Frank Lloyd Wright left Oak Park to decamp to the Arizona desert when interstates, the World Wide Web, and the web and cell phones were a distant mirage. The Whites from Harvard wrote an amazing book in the 1960s called The American Intellectual Versus the City, recounting the trajectory from Jefferson to Wright of how many American intellectuals chose the periphery, that was nothing really the periphery, to decamp and to base their avant-garde thinking. To be sure, Jane Owen was not a conventional preservationist, and she worked with like-minded individuals like Tom Mumford and later with Ralph Schwartz, who viewed preservation as a living tradition. The photo of the Carl and Laura Barrett house being moved to its new location across from the Lipschitz Gate in 1959 as part of Mrs. Owen's vision to showcase the concentration of historic buildings on Main and Granary Street speaks to the sort of things that conservative preservationists would have not approved. It was only in 2008 that she received the Louise Dupont Crowan Shield Award, the National Trust for Historic Preservation's highest national recognition. The David Lentz House seen here being moved was also part of the curatorial effort that included relocating various early settler log cabins in proximity to this harmless house. Although the Atheneum was funded by the Lilly Foundation, it was Mrs. Owen who brought Ralph Schwartz to lead Historic New Harmony, because she shared his bold vision of a diffuse museum that would encourage visitors to reach into the town as opposed to concentrating everything into one single building. Writing in the New York Times in 1979, shortly after the Atheneum opened 40 years ago, we are here to celebrate those 40 years, Ada Louise Huxtable stated, "On the banks of the Wabash River, not far from the cornfields of Indiana, stands a gleaming white structure that is as radical an addition to the rural American heartland as Le Corbusier's Villa Savoie was to the French countryside at Poissy half a century ago." Since we are here to discuss 200 years of New Harmony, a role model for the future, it is worth recalling that the very same Villa Savoie, which Huxtable compared to the Atheneum, was at risk during the 1960s when this photograph on your left was taken. Despite the worldwide fame of its architect, Le Corbusier, who was still alive at the time, the building lay in virtual ruin. This is a cautionary tale of why preservation of the modern movement requires constant attention and the same kind of care and vigilance that we are accustomed to direct toward much older historic buildings. Since 2019 is the centenary of the Bauhaus, it is worth showing the former Walter Gropius designed Bauhaus in the former East German city of Dessau that was left to disintegrate only until recently when it underwent extensive rehabilitation and is currently still being used as a school. Understanding the historicity of 20th century architecture is not an obvious feat. Not far away in Chicago, just a few years before Jane Owen was commissioning the roofless church in New Harmony, a battle was raging in Hyde Park, where the Chicago Theologian Society Seminary wanted to tear down Frank Lloyd Wright's Robie House in order to build a rather pedestrian dormitory. Thanks to the intervention of world leaders of architecture, including Wright himself and Chicago Alderman Leon Desprez, tragedy was averted, the building saved from imminent destruction, and the preservation movement in Chicago was born. But it is not enough to save 20th century buildings from demolition. We need to ensure that they meet the needs of the present and the future. This past year, back at the Ludwig Mies van der Rohe designed SR Crown Hall, opened in 1956, where I teach and where Ben Nicholson spent many years teaching, with great impact on his students, we fitted the roof with solar panels and located a nearby a Tesla battery. The panels were carefully installed on this national landmark building so that they would not be visible nor alter the use of the space. Mies often said God was in the details. Here, the panels are pulled in from the perimeter of the building and carefully located so that the only person that sees the panels from above is, of course, God. It could have been a catastrophe, were it not for the careful work of preservationists, an institution that understands its role as custodian of an architectural icon, and a dedicated community that is the type of that understands the type of expertise that these types of endeavors require. To understand the forward-thinking quality of New Harmony's Atheneum, it is worth comparing it with the visitor center in Old Economy Village in Ambridge, just outside Pittsburgh, the last of the harmonious settlements in the United States. Is anyone here from Ambridge? Okay, so I can be honest. Inaugurated in 2003 and designed by Susan Maxman and partner architects with Gillian and Harmon, the Visitor Center's volume and material palette attempts to imitate rather than reinvigorate the rap identity of this historic town. I think Meyer did a much better job here in New Harmony. As we know, the location of the Atheneum was predicated on car-based tourism. Here, Indiana State Road 66 runs through the town with Harmony Way Bridge connecting Illinois Route 14. The Harmony Way Bridge closed in 2012, just 2 years after Mrs. Owen died and was placed on Indiana's endangered list. Through relentless efforts of citizens and across the aisle cooperation leading to it being signed into law this past August, the Restore Harmony Way Bridge Act offers new possibilities. As we know, buildings, infrastructures, and towns exist within larger ecosystems. So once one aspect, like access, is threatened, so too is the rest. The aerial view of the Atheneum, the roofless church, shows the level of connectivity between the buildings and the strong presence of nature. The contributing authors to our book represent a variety of backgrounds and expertise. Architectural historian Ken Nakati wrote eloquently about the roofless church, seen here with Philip Johnson and Jane Owen viewing the distant cornfields. Although we have used cornfields in our title to denote the natural agrarian world, anyone with some knowledge of the rise of hybrid fruits and vegetables knows that the DeKalb industries developed hybrid corn in the 1930s in order to increase the yield. So in our modern world, nothing is truly authentic, and nothing is truly agrarian. I mean, so for us to sort of imagine that, so hybrid corn is as avant-garde as hybrid buildings, I would argue. It is worth mentioning that oftentimes buildings and sites need to adapt to change. For example, here we see Johnson's original paved scheme for the roofless church that was eventually modified by Jane Owen to create a softer, more welcoming indoor-outdoor connection. In the first commission of new construction, we learn of Jane Owen's initial struggle with oversight. This new building, specifically its perimeter walls, needed to be rebuilt before the roofless church needed to be preserved. It is worth recalling the Blaffer Foundation's recent efforts to restore the monumental Richards Gate. If buildings are made fragile over time due to the natural elements like rain, snow, heat, and cold, designed natural landscapes are even more so. Tillich Park is seen here, Zion and Breen's masterpiece of berms and fir trees designed to evoke the forests of Tillich's native Germany. With the maturity of living landscapes comes the need for meticulous revitalization, replanting to maintain the integrity of the original design. One of our contributing authors, Christine Gorby, examines Mrs. Owen's approach to gardens and landscapes in her chapter. Tillich Park is the site of what was to be the grotto for meditation, also known as the Cave of the New Being, that Jane Owen courageously commissioned after receiving recommendations from Philip Johnson to Austrian emigre Frederick Kiesler. And Ben dedicates a detailed chapter to this episode, together with our friend Bill Kraut, who is no longer with us. One of the sad things about taking 10 years to write a book is that the people that you start off with end up somehow disappearing. So we started off with Jane and Bill Kraut, and sadly, and Ralph Schwartz. So
So we're here to honor their memory. In fact, not by coincidence, we dedicated the book to both Jane and Rob.
Jane Owen not only commissioned buildings, gardens, and landscapes, but also buildings that could host visitors, such as New Harmony and designed by Indianapolis architect Evans Bolin. In so doing, she led the charge towards sustainable tourism before this idea became mainstream. Always attentive to different social strata, she went on to relocate a barn, here too, not a conventional thing, from Kentucky to become the McCloy Barn Abbey to host retreat groups. Here too was Jane Owen was more interested in fulfilling her vision to make New Harmony a welcoming town than following conventional preservation practices. If Jane Owen started her education in preservation through the eyes of her mother's work on St. Anne, a summer house they bought in Canada, she completed her trajectory together with her husband Kenneth Dale Owen during the multi-year restoration project for the granary seen here. We are grateful, of course, to Hafer, the firm that oversaw the restoration, for supporting our event today. Before concluding, I would like to use Jane Laffer Owen's own words. My greatest hope for New Harmony is that this place be one of healing and reconciliation. This is not to say that there won't be conflict, because there will always be conflict and differences of opinion, but we must use tools to resolve conflict. 20th century New Harmony was the seedbed of Jane Blacker Owen's communal and utopian mission to encourage a dialogue between spirituality and enlightened secular ideals, building on the legacy of the Rapp Harmonists and the Owen McClure communities. Blacker Owen's philanthropic contributions complemented other public and private initiatives. Yet, through her singular efforts to bring together artists and architects of different faiths and professional persuasion, Blacker Owen cultivated a serene and congenial community that countered the secular bravado and anxiety of the post-war era. Public and private initiatives thus created a preservation-oriented historic town in the cornfields of Indiana that also became a place to observe avant-garde art, architecture, and landscape architecture. Yet, just as utopias are never complete, so too avant-garde in cornfields, by focusing on building and landscapes, lays the groundwork for further studies about the myriad complementary culture activities that contribute to New Harmony's 20th century Renaissance. There in the sky. So that's her looking up over us.
So if anybody has any questions of any scale, type, or subject, Michelangelo will surely want to respond to it.
Hi.
I
know. How did you ultimately focus on the things that you did in the book? And in other words, how did you kind of narrow it down to the subjects that finally ended up in the book?
Great. Well, it was, you know, so Ben and I met at the University of Houston, where he was running a studio on Kiesler. And through that opportunity, I became acquainted with New Harmony, Joe Mashburn, who was the former dean at the University of Houston, Gerald Lee Hines College of Architecture, was also interested in sort of developing a relationship with Jane Owen. And so there was a moment of great sort of, I knew nothing about New Harmony, so Ben was my teacher, Mashburn. And so we began with a focus on Kiesler and various avant-garde architectures. But then as we moved through the project, we understood, you know, the Zion Green, Tillich Park is a masterpiece, and Zion is a major figure in American landscape architecture, you know, the Pocket Park, New York. And so it became obvious, or Ralph Mayer's sort of boulders, I mean, it became obvious that Jane was one hell of a sophisticated woman and was bringing all these people to this place, and but it was, that was the kind of commissioning you. But then her, let's say, unorthodox preservation, right, that was reinforced through also Ralph Schwartz, I mean, the two went hand in hand. When I mentioned, you know, the Rockefellers, you know, on the one hand supporting the reconstruction of Williamsburg, and the other hand, you know, funding the Museum of Modern Art, well, that's a very illuminated, so we didn't, I mean, Ben should answer this question as soon as I stop talking. You know, we felt that, you know, that complex sort of coexistence of these different and sort of impulses was what the book needed. Right? And so Ben,
writing a book over a 10-year period is a very long time, probably much more than true. And we realized that when Jane Owen died, there was a bigger story here than looking at one part of her life. And our first press that we worked with, the University of Chicago, who ultimately rejected us, they were adamant that we tell a much bigger story. They said, you can't speak about harmony unless you work with notions of preservation, unless you work with the grand narrative of what this town stands for in the 20th century. And we had a very tragic time of changing authors and shaking hands, and they put their essays in other journals, and we completely rebuilt the book. That's ultimately what took us so long to do this. We all got wiser and more knowledgeable and more grateful for the pushback.
Absolutely, and then, you know, when I ended this talk, saying that there's plenty to be done, even in terms of, I mean, we focus on the built environment, but there's still plenty to be done on cultural initiatives that Jane brought forward. And so we see this as just the beginning. One of the pushback we received was that, you know, we were being too hagiographic, that, you know, that we were trying to honor Jane Black Rowan too much, and that, you know, be careful because, you know, there was forces, and of course she didn't start preservation in harmony, it started well in the 30s, and so there's plenty of, you know, work that was done. So we had to also temper that, you know, because they were concerned that this was going to come across as a hagiographical. So, you know, and the one.
It's interesting because once you have the book in your hand, you can actually see what happened. And what I would say the book has certainly taught me is that in the process of building something, our first chapter written by Nancy is about the education of the person. All of the things that they looked at and the people they met and the basis for which they then became the philanthropist. And then in our second chapter, we deal with philanthropy in Indiana and Houston and what it took for these enormous cultural projects out of Cummins Engine and down with the Menils down in Houston. And this is a complicated project. And so for anybody who's interested in commissioning a building, we thoroughly recommend you buy this book. it will be really useful.
Where is it?
But then, once we get into the cadence of the book, the chapters discuss the enormous difficulty of commissioning and the tension that lies between the architect, the patron, the person that buys the project, and the lawsuits that take place. It's a pretty grisly story, and one of the chapters deals with the complete collapse of the project. And all the building materials were bought, all of the site was prepared, and boom, due to philosophical reasons, the project is cut. So this is not an easy book. It's a journey that left us after these 10 years.
Well, at a certain point, you can't be pregnant. I've never had a child. There's a child, but you can't be pregnant that long. And so, right? Otherwise.
It was cut out. This is a cesarean book.
In any case, but as I said, we see this as an opportunity to offer the community sort of a reference book that, you know, and we, thanks also to Nancy who labored with us, you know, we're super, super careful to gather things, like for example, the Hawkins painting in the, you know, the Working Man's Institute. I mean, that would maybe be an even more pedantic historian saying, you know, I haven't seen this reproduced anywhere. Let's get it in the book, because even though the 19th century is not our focus, but anyone that's still wanting to put it. So again, that required a whole, you know, tracking down. So we were, and I you know, I appreciate our collaboration with Ben a lot, because Ben did not come into this as a sort of standard historian with a PhD in architectural history, but he was equally rigorous and perhaps more inventive than a PhD would be. So, and that was, you know, again, an opportunity, and he was invested, and he is invested in this place. So it was for me a wonderful opportunity. And then by chance, you know, I came to the Midwest after Texas. So. This is a nice way that we can, you know, conclude. Go ahead.
Yeah. I just want to comment. I think I bought it the first day it was on sale downstairs. I think I do tours here. I've been heavily invested for 3 or 4 years now with Historic New Harmony and doing the tours and teaching people about our magic town. This book, I would personally thank both of you. It is a tremendous gift to the town to have a scholarly book. You know, I mean, Mrs. Owen was her personal account, you know, and so you got to kind of sort through all the Mrs. Owen stuff. You know, this is a scholarly book about our town, and it's fabulous to be able to have that resource that, you know, well-researched, you know, the things you're citing out of the book are facts. They're not, well, I heard one time that this is what happened. It's a tremendous gift to the town, and I personally thank you both.
We were very, very careful about not winging anything, and have much to thank Nancy for doing this. She would hold our feet absolutely to the fire, and so we could not take it anymore. There will be, and there are, a lot of footnotes, but that's because the book holds up. We're happy to have provided a benchmark as a piece of publication for this decade about what has happened recently, where we can go in the future, and how it might be done.
Did we have a question here
on
the front?
No, I just want to echo one of the comments here and say the book is radical.
Thank you.
We're going to reconvene at a little bit before 4:30 and kick off right